This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Steve Aspin is back with us. Steve was with us in June, and so you may ask yourself, why is he back so soon? Because normally we wait maybe a year or more between guest appearances, unless they're, like some of our guests, extremely prolific. But Steve has not published a new book. He's had quite an adventure with Amazon, though, similar to the one I'm having with Audible, or had with Audible. Steve's book is Out of Time, The Intergenerational Abduction Program Explored. And when we discussed it in June, it was on Amazon. It was readily available from him, through his account. Steve, what happened then?
Well, Whitley, we recorded our last interview in late March. And although I asked you to delay the broadcast until June because of this incident that happened with Amazon, on the 31st of March, well, it's a little bit of background. I noticed in January, I got a very peculiar message from Amazon by email, saying that my name had been associated with another account, another KDP account, which they were absolutely certain of. And this account had violated the terms and conditions of the content violations, basically. So I wrote straight back to them and said, could you give me some details, please? Whose name is this account in? I'd absolutely no clue what they were talking about. And I got no response to that at all. And then I noticed in February, number of the reviews that were posted on the book, none of these people I knew, but I had about 20 five-star reviews on the book, which had been on the market since September, and one other review which wasn't five-star. Some of the reviews started disappearing from the international sites. So how the Amazon review system works is that if you buy the book in the United States and you post a review on Amazon, on the book's the product page on Amazon, it shows up in the United States and all over the world and the other Amazon sites as a verified purchase review. That means Amazon can trace the fact that you bought it from Amazon, and that review is published all over the world. If you buy it from Barnes & Noble, or you're given it as a gift or whatever, and you review the book, the review appears only on the Amazon.com site, but it doesn't go outside the home jurisdiction in the United States. So there was a lot of reviews from Germany and France, and one from New Zealand, and a lot from the US, showed up on Amazon.co.uk and all the other world Amazon sites. And they started disappearing one at a time in February and March. And I was curious about that. I actually didn't raise it. I just thought maybe it was a glitch that will just fix itself in a week or so. And then on the 31st of March, I woke up and looked at the phone as I was, you know, putting the kettle on. And I had a message from KDP saying that my Kindle Direct Publishing account had been suspended, taken offline, and as an author, I no longer had access to it. And that was the end of the message. I received another message about 24 hours later saying that my accounts have been terminated because of content violations, and citing that I'd made some posts, apparently, or somebody had made some posts which had violated the content rules of Amazon, and that I in some way was claimed to be associated with this other account. So I asked for details because this was completely news to me. I mean, it's all a complete mystery. And I never got a satisfactory explanation. They just, I appealed against the decision, and was told after 5 or 6 or 7 days when I made a number of phone calls. And you, when you phone the Amazon organization, if you're a published author, normally you have to go through a several stage process of pressing, 2 for this and 3 for that. And you get through to somebody in Bangalore who doesn't know what the heck you're talking about. So you explain everything to them, and they you quote the case number, and they say eventually they'll get somebody to phone you back, and nobody ever phones you back. So 2 or 3 days later, I phoned again, and I finally got through to somebody in Manila who, and I had to start all over again. You know, they knew nothing about the case. So I explained it all to them, quoted the references and so forth. And again, the same story, that they would find somebody to phone me back, and I was never called back. And on the 12th of April, I was finally told by a simple email message that the account was going to stay terminated, and the book was withdrawn from sale. And that was the end of the dealings. I mean, I saw no sense in pursuing it any further, because they said they'd made an irrevocable decision and taken this book offline, and they weren't going to sell it anymore. They weren't going to host it. This left me in a bit of a fix, because I'd published it with Kindle Direct Publishing, through Kindle Direct Publishing, and Amazon was in charge of all the print copies, and they were the only distributor of the ebook. So I was completely left high and dry. Had I used a different publisher, I could probably have continued to print it and sold it through other retail outlets. So the book was basically offline from 31st of March, when the account was closed. And the explanations I had about this from Amazon were completely unsatisfactory. I mean, I don't know what you'd make of this if you had a similar experience. There were a couple of other authors, interestingly, UK authors. Malcolm Robinson was one who's published 20 books, and is a full-time researcher. He's got an organization who investigates poltergeist phenomena and so forth. All his books were taken offline as well, and he had the same message from Amazon. But after 2 months, his account was quietly restored, and he wasn't told. He just found out about it by accident, and his royalties resumed. And I'd had been discussing with him of bringing a legal case against Amazon, but he declined to go that route in any case. There was at least one other author that I've been in contact with, Ron. I can't remember his surname now. There's so many people I've been doing. And you said that to me, that you'd looked up these couple of authors, and their books were on sale again. In my case,
are on sale again. That's correct.
Yeah, yeah. In my case, it's complete. I'm completely banned from the Amazon organization. So I had to start all over again and republish. And I chose a small UK independent publisher called Grosvenor House Publishing, quite high quality outfit in Surrey, and they have republished a book in hardcover, a cloth bound hardcover. That here, it's fantastic, really quality artifact with 105 GSM paper and a color interior. And the second format is a paperback, which is very similar to the first edition. And the third format is the ebook. So they've all been gone onto the market after the 24th of August, which was last Thursday. And they're in the United States. They'll be available from Barnes and Noble and every high street bookseller in the country. So I'm no longer dependent on Amazon to distribute the book.
Yes.
Will not be. Having said that, interestingly enough, they have initiated a product page for the books, in the new books format, the new Grosvenor House publications. And you can buy the hardcover, the paperback and ebook from Amazon.com, no problem. But they're not published out by Amazon.com. So I can't really make any sense of this. It's been off the market for three and a half months. and it's now available again. And it's all been very time consuming, very annoying, and very frustrating. And I just, you know, all I can do to you is relate the facts to you as I've just described them.
When we get back, folks, I'm going to relate my facts to you because I've had trouble too. And I think something's going on at Amazon, and I think we all need to know about it. It needs to be out in the public space. And so I will be, when we come back, I'll be talking about my problems. And then we're going to be talking about the relationship between these big companies and authors they maybe don't like. And what that means. We'll be right back.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. Unknowncountry.com subscribers have access to a vast treasury of information. Listen to what Dr. Robert Schock said. He's an expert on the past, and for that reason, he also knows a great deal about the future.
We are re-entering, as you say, a debris field, and when you have a debris field like this, it enters the solar system, it energizes the solar system as you have things going into the sun. Even clouds of dust particles, for instance, it will energize the sun, it will destabilize the sun. This is what we saw at the end of the last ice age, in approximate terms, about 13,000 years ago.
And just in the past few days, more enormous meteors have been sighted, and this goes on continuously, more and more every year. We live in a time of great change in a world that doesn't like to look at things as they are. UnknownCountry.com offers extraordinary information, a vast archive that you cannot find anywhere else. Subscribe today. Help keep this website going, because without you, there is and can be no us. Go to UnknownCountry.com. Right now, click on the subscribe tab, get started.
We're back. We're talking to Steve Aspin, his book, Out of Time. Do get it. You can obviously get it practically anywhere now. You can get it on Amazon. You can get it on Barnes & Noble's. You can get it on Waterstones in the UK. You can get it in your high street bookseller, as he puts it. And I'm going to be in the UK soon, and I'll go to my high street bookseller and see if they have it. I hope they do, and if they don't, I'll ask for it. So, and you can get it from your bookstore, of course, in the US. The book, in other words, has not been suppressed, but somebody has been beaten up. Steve Aspin has been beaten up by a process that obviously does not work. Now, I say this from experience, because years ago, I suddenly got an email from Amazon saying that I had been reviewing books of my friends in violation of their policies. And the problem was, I hate doing book reviews, frankly. And I had been asked by many friends to do book reviews of their books, and been procrastinating. And I probably reviewed maybe one or two books, not of my friends, and or maybe of friends. But in any case, it's not, it's a really a gray area in Amazon. So that was, you're supposed to be review books that you have read. And, you know, I had read all the books I reviewed, and I think most of them were probably books of people who had been on Dreamland, who I liked and thought I was impressed by and wrote the review of. And then I shortly thereafter got a notice saying, you're forever banned from reviewing books on Amazon. I telephoned them. And in those days, it was a long time ago, you didn't end up in Bangladesh when you telephoned them as you do now. I talked to a person here and said very frankly that I'd never knowingly reviewed any book in violation of their reviewing policies, which I knew quite well. I'd read them. And then he said, well, that, and I put this on appeal, and then I got a notice saying that I would never allow to be reviewing a book or anything on Amazon again. And I thought at first, how annoying. And then I thought, oh, good. Now when people ask me to review books on Amazon, I can just tell them I've been banned. So I just left it. Now, however, something extremely terrible happened. Terrible, a few weeks ago. It involves the Amazon subsidiary, Audible.com. What happened was this. At the end of July, I received my June royalty statement from Audible. The royalty statement comes about 3 or 4 days before the money is deposited in your account. And the royalty statement came. There was no question about the amount. I'm sure it was probably quite accurate, although I have to wonder just a bit about that now. The money didn't show up. And it didn't show up for a week. So I called them, and I got the people in Bangladesh who sent me to the people in Calcutta, etc. I mean, I'm not disparaging these people, but they don't speak English well, and it's clear that they perceive their jobs as to say the customer or the complainant is wrong. They're not helpful, and I think it has, maybe it's a cultural thing, I don't know, or maybe they're told to be that way by Amazon. But I called and I explained the problem, and finally I got to somebody who was very helpful and was in Bangladesh or wherever he said he was. I believe he did say Bangladesh. I asked him where he was, and he said he would escalate this to the finance department and they would contact me shortly because it was a serious problem and they would certainly look at it. Nothing happened. I didn't receive a word from any finance department. So I called again about a week later. Now nearly 2 weeks have passed. Same thing. Escalate to the finance department. They will be in touch with you immediately. But because of the way their system works, the second guy had no access to the file of the first call. Therefore, to him, it was another first call. And that's wrong. I mean, when somebody has a complaint like this, it should be in a file that when they return, they should have been given a number or something that would have enabled the individual on the other end of the line to see what had already happened. But that does not happen. So again, no response from the finance department. Now I'm getting frantic because I need this money. This is my life's work. People will always say, well, why do you have to charge for your books? And I have to laugh because this is all I do. It's my work. If I, you know, as it is, if Steve and I counted out our earnings based on an hourly rate as to how many hours we'd spent on our books, I don't think he'd be making a pound an hour. I'd be amazed. I would not be making a pound an hour. Believe me, I wouldn't even be making a dollar an hour. And yet there's that friction. But not from most people. Most people understand that if you do work, you need to get paid in this culture. Otherwise, you die. So I'm pretty frantic at this point because this is my main source of income. And I don't know where to turn. I'm just in shock, be best way to put it. Absolutely in shock. So I think to myself, I'm going to put this out in public. And things get much more complicated because I sent copies of them to the entire Senate Intelligence Committee. At this point, this is all still going on with Audible. I then have a speaking engagement at the Lilydale Assembly of the Spiritualist Church of America in Casadega, New York. I stop at the Chautauqua Institution nearby, which is a place where Ann and I used to go and love very much. We used to go every summer for years. And I stop there kind of for old time's sake for an overnight. I notice that while I'm going there, that I'm being followed from the airport in Buffalo. And I think, okay, someone recognized me and followed me. That happens. And I've taken a training about how to detect a tail and how to lose a tail. Because in my position, that does happen. And it's often very innocent. It's often just somebody who recognizes me and sees me and wants to maybe, you know, talk to me or something. And they're just a little bit overly aggressive. There's nothing, you generally no harm in it. And I don't think this type was one either, but I'm not going to go into detail about how this works, obviously. But I performed the maneuvers necessary to, I ended up on a side road with the tail still behind me. And in the process of realizing that I was not going into the motel they thought I was going into, and sitting behind me with wide-eyed expressions on their face. And I just turned around and went on down the road. And I thought, well, it's obviously a fan of something who shouldn't have been doing things like that. And California, it's called stalking, and it's against the law, but it's not true in New York. So I went on to Chautauqua, whereupon I discovered that Christian Gillibrand, the senator who is leading the charge against the DOD, was going to speak on the day I happened to be there, purely by chance. And now I thought to myself, that tale takes another twist, because I have a feeling that was the intelligence community. They would know that I had sent my book, Them, to the whole Senate Intelligence Committee, and they were tailing me because they thought I was planning to hook up with Christian Gillibrand at the conference. And the last thing they want is for the abductions to become a part of the dialogue about UFO and UAP secrecy. That is an absolute line in the sand for them. Of course, it was just seemingly just chance that I happened to be there on the day she spoke. I didn't talk to her. I didn't listen to her speak, as if they could imagine that I would be so unsophisticated as to try to buttonhole a United States senator and say, hey, I would like to tell you about alien abductions while she's walking through the streets of a Chautauqua institution. Forget it. I would never try that. I have a much more rational ways of dealing with this. So one senator sent me a form letter back from the Senate Intelligence Committee acknowledging the receipt of the book. And I have to wonder if they were intercepted, perhaps, and all thrown out, which could have easily happened. In any case, so all of that's going on. I spent a few nights at the old cabin with the lovely, lovely family who now own it. And I had incredible experiences there that I'm going to go into in the third half, the third part of the show. Anyway, so here's the situation. I have no money. I mean, my money's being taken. I do have some money. I'm not hand to mouth, but my money is being held back. I have had this following incident, the chance passage, ships passing in the night with Christian Gellibrand, and I'm just nuts by this time. I call a lawyer, and not just any lawyer. I'm not going to tell you his name, but he has got a reputation as being a really ferocious and effective plaintiff's attorney. He's well known in legal circles. I also first met him when I held him in my arms when he was 3 days old. So he turned out to be the right lawyer for me. He got on to Audible's chief of their head attorney. And Friday, I received a notice from Audible. This is now, I don't know exactly when we're going to run this. It's probably going to not be right away. This is August the 28th. Last Friday, I received a notice from Audible saying that they had paid both payments. The lawyer simply sent them a letter saying, you're in breach of contract. And that's a serious thing. They were obviously completely in breach. Illegal action. Illegal withholding of these funds that they admitted that they owed to the penny. So the money, as of this morning, August the 28th, has arrived in my account. So far, I have received no explanation. The lawyer has apparently received no explanation from Audible as to what happened. And I don't think they will. And I think, Steve, that this is where we are. And I know of another author. I haven't contacted him yet. An astrologer who's having the same problem with Amazon not paying it. Just not paying him and not saying why and not responding. I think that there are people working in these companies who don't like certain subjects and that they are harassing people who write on those subjects. I think that's what this is all about. And that Amazon, being so huge, is unable to successfully self-police. Basically, that's what it is. I don't think it's a secret cabal of intelligence officers or anything like that. I would be amazed if that was the case. I mean, anything is possible. But I think that basically we're being harassed from within a company that has not got the checks in place to stop this. I think that's what's happening.
You could be right about that, Willie. I don't really know the causative agency of this interference. I would have probably put it down to a malfunctioning algorithm and something of that nature, were it not for the reviews of my book being manipulated and deleted over 4, 5, 6 weeks. And that was something deliberate, and it takes human interference from somebody inside the Amazon organization.
I think that's exactly what I'm talking about. It's human interference. Yeah. Someone interfered who had absolutely no right to do that. They interfered with you. They may have even created some account that you can't see. That has your name associated with it. Because if they're within Amazon, I mean, God, they must have carte blanche.
Yeah, something of now, that nature.
This is very important, folks. If you are a writer and or have books on any of these platforms, any Amazon-related platforms, and you get into trouble like this, please let me know. At Whitley@Strieber.com, because we've got to go to the, I'm taking my case to the Authors Guild, and I think you should take your case to the Authors Guild too, Steve.
Okay.
This needs to be known. I thought about taking it to the Pan American Center, but it's already been made clear to me that Penn defends authors who are worth defending. And unfortunately, I'm not one of those as far as they're concerned. I still contribute to Ben because they do good work, but they do not like me. I'm too out there for them. So in any case, I think the Authors Guild should hear about things like this. And what's it called in the UK? There is an Authors Guild in the UK.
I don't know. I get messages from the Authors Guild all the time, so I'm kind of in touch with them. I think it's just the Authors Guild. I don't know whether maybe there's another one here. Is it a pen? Something like that.
What?
I don't know. I don't know.
Anyway, we should definitely get in touch with them.
Unlike you, Whitley, I've not been a professional author for my career. I retired a few years ago, and At a Time was my first book ever published. Yeah. So this was all new to me, really, this world.
I don't think that this is some sinister intelligence operation at all. I think Amazon needs to clean house because they have people in their ecosystem who are censoring books and harassing authors they don't like, I think, and using the system to do that. I think that's almost certainly the case. And
do you suspect they're operating on alone, or do you think there's a group of them?
I would think it's a religious group.
Religious group.
Mm-hmm. A religious group or a political
Interesting
group.
Interesting thought, yeah.
And I think that they're probably being very careful. Because the other author that I know of who has been being stiffed at the present time by Amazon is an author of astrology books. So you get Alien Abduction and Astrology, and you see these are occult books. And my guess is that there are people inside Amazon at some level, and I won't say necessarily Christian fundamentalists, because there are a lot of people, Hindu fundamentalists, Christian fundamentalists, Muslims, people with believers of all kinds who have reason to object to our work. And I think that these people are there, and that if they're successful, they're going to get bolder, and it's going to become very chaotic for a lot of authors. I don't know how many other authors outside of our community have had these problems, but there might be a lot. It might be a very much of an undiscovered issue, and that's what I'm going to bring up with the Authors Guild, and I'm hoping that the Authors Guild will then get into touch with Amazon, because this is not something... Amazon is a very effective publishing house. I could not still publish if it wasn't for Amazon and Audible. I respect them enormously, and I love their work and their effectiveness. People can click on something, and if they want to buy a hardcover or softcover of my book, they can get it overnight, anywhere in the world, practically. Or a wonderful audio book and all of that. That is wonderful. It's wonderful, especially an author like me, where 9 out of 10 buyers in the bookstore community just snicker when they see the name Whitley Strieber. They don't want to put my books up in their stores. But I've still got a big audience, and it's because of Amazon and Audible and Barnes & Noble, and the others a distant second. But I think of this as a problem that they have that we can help them solve and continue to be sure Amazon remains the wonderful company that it is. That's for writers. That is, and I know that we have all kinds of objections to Amazon. It's becoming a monopoly, but not in the book trade. It's a player in the book trade, but it's by no means a monopoly. So,
yeah, it's not a monopoly, but it's a very, very big one. Maybe the largest, certainly the largest online retailer of books worldwide, I would think.
Yeah,
but it's not. They don't have a monopoly.
I also think that they have greatly increased the amount of reading that's being done.
Yeah,
and created a whole new kind of reading with Audible books, a whole new kind of reader. I think it's a wonderful outfit, and we need to help it get better. That's my attitude. So, okay, now let's talk about what in your book might have made somebody, let's say it's a religious group of some kind, decide they needed to give you trouble? Wait a minute, Steve. I'm jumping the gun in two ways. First, it's time for a break, and second, we need to go back and have you tell your story briefly. Steve told it in June, but I want him to remind you briefly of what is the book is about, and then we'll go on to what it may be that caused this to happen, if I'm right about why it happened. We'll be right back. This is a brief excerpt from an interview with two contactees who had an 11-day close encounter experience and are now willing to speak about it, really, for the first time. To hear their whole interview and many others, subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Here's the excerpt. Did you see the man's face?
Yes. Actually, that one is very clear to me. It was kind of longish, and he didn't look completely human, but because he had very, very thin hair, almost non-existent, but he was young, I believe that it was kind of blonde. And he was very tall, like at least six feet. And he was so thin that he looked kind of strange.
And what happened then?
Well, he wanted me to go with him, or to stay with him. He wanted me to stay with him on the ship. And I'd been married for 6 months, and I wasn't about to go running off to stay on the ship.
Now, surely you want more. You must want more. And there is more. Not only this contactee interview, but many others, many of them just as extraordinary, on unknowncountry.com, plus everything else that we offer, my audio books, the meditations, the talks on the key, William Henry's wonderful revelation show and its entire run, and Strieber's brilliant and magical mysterious powers, and so much more. Hours and hours of listening pleasure. Learn from the meditations on the site. Really learn, because they're real and they're valuable. Subscribe to unknowncountry.com right now. Go to unknowncountry.com. Click on the subscribe tab. We are running very low on new subscribers now, and that should not be. It should not be happening. So you do it. You go there and you do it today.
We're talking to Steve Aspin, his new book, Out of Time, in more ways than one. In this case, he seems to have been run out of time by Amazon. Out of Time.
Out of stock.
Right. The Intergenerational Abduction Program Explored. Somebody didn't like that enough to try to kick you off Amazon and silence you. That's the bottom line here. So tell us a little bit about the book.
Well, it's a book about the abduction phenomenon, which is not talked about that much nowadays. And it's excluded from the very public dialogue around David Grusher's revelations and his testimony to, the U.S. Congress over the past few weeks, and a number of other people have testified to the Congress, you know, about the UAP issue and about the ATIP program and the OSAP programs and so forth over the past 15 years. So it's completely excluded from the dialogue, but it's my contention. I'm a lifetime experiencer of these events, which I didn't work out were in any way related to aliens or non-human intelligences or extraterrestrial life forms. I have no idea that it was anything to do with that until in my when I was about 50, actually, in 2007, that's when it all fell into place, and I began to pursue it with a determination and certainty that that was the causative agency. And I began to investigate and read up on the abduction phenomenon in a way that I'd never been inclined to do before. But it's there since infancy. I mean, I devote the first chapter of the book to my experiences from infancy until middle age, when a long series of bizarre and peculiar events like UFO sightings, missing time episodes, and a sighting of two grey aliens in a hotel room in Sardinia with my father, or a very vivid, realistic image of my father standing between them, and a cattle mutilation, which I saw when I was 14 years old in Ireland. I was taken to visit a close-up cattle mutilation, exactly like those that have plagued farmers in the Midwest.
Okay, tell us a little bit. Well, before, let's get to the cattle mutilation in more detail in a moment. But before that, tell us about your early experiences and what your grandmother said they were.
Yeah. I asked one of the, I used to have these episodes at night, every few weeks, when I was paralyzed and I was surrounded by these little creatures who had a very unpleasant, musty smell to them. And I felt I was manhandled and moved about, and I could never move a muscle in those these instances. And one time I was lying on my back on one of these tables they put you on, and I asked the one who seemed to be in charge, a slightly taller one, who had his back to me at the time, why they were doing this to me. What I had done to deserve this? What was the reason? Did everybody go through this, or is it just some of us, or was it just me? Probably not just me. And he said to me, telepathically, because that's the way they talk to you, he said, "Oh, it's because of your mother and your grandmother and your great grandmother, and you're the next in the line." And it's very factual, very matter of fact. And he just carried on with what he was doing. The next time I met my grandmother, who died within about 18 months of this particular conversation with this entity, the next time I met my grandmother, I asked her about these nighttime incidents and whether she recognized what I was talking about. And she said, "Oh, Stevie, they're just the pixies. They're the pixies. They'll always bring you back. Don't worry." And she had this framework for it, that this happened to a lot of kids, or most kids, and you just had to wait until a child asked you about it, and you just explained to them that they were pixies and they took you away, and they always brought you back. And she was completely adjusted to it as her reality. I don't recall this ever being any part of the conversation between her and my mother, you know, her daughter, and any other members of the family, or where I was present. It never came up. But now, just on this one occasion, I asked her, and that's what she said.
Let's take a pause here, folks. I want to put up something, a photograph of a gray, a pixie, if you will, coming up out of a basement in Mexico. As I'm talking, you're now seeing it. And this is almost certainly a real image. Now, I know that members of the skeptics community will say it's a fake and this and that. But if it is a fake, it's still real, because this is what I've seen, including, and you notice it has a vagina. And I saw one comment about it. "Oh, it can't be an alien. They wouldn't have vaginas." Ha! No, why not? They're sort of angelic beings who reproduce out of their left ears? I don't think so. This is what I see. And another thing that could happen is that someone can put up another picture and say, "This I made this, and this is how it was done." And yes, that's true. You can make one that looks just like that, but that doesn't mean this image isn't real. Even if this image isn't real, it is so accurate that it is truly an image of one of these individuals and coming up out of a basement. And the reason is the same reason that Steve would smell a musty smell when would come near him. They come from underground. The theater in the sky, Annie, remember, always said, it's a theater in the sky, a theater in the sky. They're making us look up while they come from below. Does that mean they only live below and this is also their world? It may. Or it may be that they came from originally from somewhere else and have lodged themselves below. We don't know the answer to that question. But they are quite real. And now, and this is going to be the subject of my next book, why do they come up from below? Why were they so interested in Steve? And what about the generational aspect of it? Steve knows a lot more about this. We're going to take a final break, and then we're going to talk to him in more depth about just what that generational aspect of it may mean. We'll be right back. My new book, Them, has now been out since March of 2023. I would like to thank everyone for the wonderful reception, those who have read it, who have posted thoughtful reviews on Amazon, those who have listened. It's an important book for me. And also, over the months, it has become a very strange book, because if you listen to the Oversight Committee UAP hearings, you will hear David Grush saying things that almost sound like they were taken right out of the second part of Them. And I thought to myself, how did I do that? And the answer is, I have no idea. But the book is really very prophetic, and I think you should read it if you hadn't done so, and that's what this is all about. Read it, listen to it. It's really worth your time. Jacques Vallée certainly thought so. Mitch Horowitz thought so. Jeff Kripal thought so. Leslie Kane, Diana Pasolka, and all of the others who gave it blurbs thought so, and so do an awful lot of people who have reviewed it. So pick up a copy today. Go to Amazon and get a copy. Go to Audible and get the audio book. Listen to them. Read them. It's a whole new vision of how we should think about the close encounter experience. And this is getting more and more important over time. More and more important. Them. I saw the future when I was writing that book. Didn't know I would, but I did. You can read it now and see for yourself. We're talking to Steve Aspin. His new book, Out of Time, The Intergenerational Abduction Program Explored. Now, Steve, we've come pretty far down this road. Can you let us know exactly what you think and have come to conclude is the reason for this intergenerational abduction program?
Yeah, well, in the book, in chapter 8 and chapter 9 in the book, the last two chapters, I do present evidence that the program probably started in the 1890s, and I do bring a fair bit of evidence to that. It may have been a little earlier, but I don't think it was after 1900. I think this has been going on about 120 years now. And so we're into the fourth or fifth or maybe sixth generation, depending on, you know, the length of a generation, the time interval of a generation. The alien which spoke to me when I was 10, 11 years old and told me that it was before because of your mother and your grandmother and your great grandmother, and the very, very strong impression I had from him was that that was it. It wasn't, nothing was happening before that. Your great grandmother was the start of it. Your mother, your grandmother, and your great grandmother, full stop. And my great grandmother was born in 1873. And by 1890, she would have been 17 years old, which is the start of the reproductive years for a female. And in those days, lots of girls were married at 17. Some were married much later, of course, but she had a first child in 1908. So she married fairly late-ish. My grandmother was her only child. And I think the intergenerational thing must be something to do with them changing the genetic makeup very subtly in ways that our geneticists can't detect, or they're not looking for it. They must be making some subtle generational changes to the abductees. One of the curious things is that one of the things I go into in a later chapter was that, you know, the reproductive cycles of humans, the human females have all their oocytes created when they're in the womb before they're born. So by the time a baby girl is born, she's got several million oocytes in her body, which at the onset of puberty, they develop into ovarian follicles, and one is released roughly every 28 days for the whole of her adult life until she's about 50, when menopause kicks in. So she releases about 500 oocytes, some of which develop into babies if they're fertilized, and she becomes pregnant. Human males have the diametrically opposite happen to them. They don't have any sperm produced at all until puberty, and then sperm production starts, and it doesn't stop until a man dies. Even if he lives to 110 years old, he's still producing some sperm. It's considerably reduced, like all physiological functions are, you know, as you age, but it never stops. So he has some sperm production, even if the motility and numbers are down, he's still producing. And one of the things that male abductees have always told me is that those who have a good recall, or train themselves to have a good recall, is that they have sperm samples taken, so far as they know, on every single abduction event. And the question is, why would they do that? Because you think that any sort of sentient life form would, with advanced science and biology, you know, understandings, which they obviously have, would realize that if they get one sperm sample, they can freeze it or sustain it somehow and use it for millions and millions of offspring if they want to create offspring from them. But they always go back to the well. Every few weeks, they get another sperm sample from the man. Every time the man's abducted, this happens. And there's a variety of ways they do it. They, you know, they put something over the whole groin area, and it's a kind of suction device when the man's lying down on the table. Or occasionally they have female abductees or female hybrids assist them in very imaginative ways. Men who've had vasectomies also have sperm taken by the insertion of a very small needle at the back of the testes, just behind the testes. So they have, and that sometimes they resort to a technique of electro ejaculation, which where the man.
That's what happened to me.
Yes, well, you can confirm that, and then.
And that happened to me, absolutely. And also, I had an incident of sex, but it wasn't with a hybrid. It was with one like the picture. That's why I know they have vaginas.
Yes. So this sperm taking from the sperm that's constantly produced by a man's testes, even from men who've had vasectomies, in other words, have had a physical surgical intervention to prevent the sperm being ejaculated through the urethra. They have a technique for all that, and they're experienced with it all, and they know exactly what they're doing. And there's must be a reason why they do this, why they take so much sperm from all their male abductees. And I think it must be because the abductees are being slowly genetically modified, and the modifications in the abductees, because the sperm is all freshly manufactured, must be present in the sperm somehow. That's the reason why they keeps taking the sperm samples. I don't know if anybody has a different explanation for this. Very keen to hear it, but I have
a sort of supporting observation. Two things. One, a needle was put into the side of my head when I was in my abduction experience in 1985. Two, it has been observed on MRI scans that a certain area of the brain is apparently connected somehow with this. It is the white matter between two parts of the executive function of the brain, the caudate and the putamen, and this white matter is associated with, it's not really very well known what it does, but high density white matter seems to be associated with a high level of psychic ability. I don't have high density white matter. I have high normal density white matter, but there are people who have been studied by Dr. Christopher Green, Kit Green, whose white matter is really dense, and they're very psychic and very involved in the experience. In my case, as he put it, the connections are totally unique in his experience. And this is a man with probably 50 years of experience as a neurologist, or maybe more by now. And he had never seen a brain like it. And I think you're looking at a person whose brain was altered by them, probably so that I can be what I am now, which is I use the implant. And very frankly, I'm linked to them so completely that when I meditate late at night at 3 o'clock in the morning, it used to be that I would struggle to connect with whatever it was that was trying to connect with me at that time. Now it's like being plugged in, and I'm working. My new book, the one I'm working on right now, is more of a team effort than any of the others. So you're looking at that evolution in action here, I think. And it's an evolution toward, in my case, a linking between us and them. Why don't you tell us a little bit about your impressions of why they would be doing this?
In the 1970s and 1980s, a lot of female abductees claimed that they were pregnant without cause, not in a relationship, and they just became pregnant. And they furthermore said that that was confirmed by medical authorities, and
yes,
that somehow they, after that, about 10 weeks usually was the optimum time, the pregnancy disappeared without any bleeding, and they suddenly knew they weren't pregnant again. And there's accounts from female abductees of having the fetus removed from them. And furthermore, this sounds crazy to somebody who doesn't know the subject, but abductees also reported through the 80s and 90s and maybe not after that they, when they were on board abducted, they were asked to, or made to, or encouraged to hold a baby, a little baby thing, really small baby, and feed it and nurture it and cherish it and radiate love to it. And there were a lot of stories about people seeing in these craft that they were taken to, rows and rows of tanks of brown fluid in which a fetus or embryo was floating. And this was very, very commonly reported. I mean, even Terry Lovelace reported this during one of his major abductions in the 1980s, the Devil's Den incident. But he writes about that, that he was in the room with hundreds of tanks of little babies in. So they were rearing that these babies are obviously, quote, born, unquote, at some point. In other words, they became separate lives that didn't need that kind of sustenance as they grew. And people then reported they were dealing with hybrid children, which I actually remember in my case throughout the 1980s and 90s. I was dealing with.
Tell us more children. About the hybrid children.
I just have a nighttime incident.
Hold on. We've reached the end of the first hour, so I have to take a break and say goodbye to our free listeners. And I said that I would be talking about some things that had happened to me in the third half hour. I'm going to put that, folks, into the subscriber section separately. And because Steve and I have got a lot to talk about and we haven't finished yet by any means. Okay, so we'll be right back.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.